Program on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. Thank you for joining us. I'm your host for today, Zoe Loftus-Farron. The cosmetics and personal care industry is huge, and it's not hard to see why. The industry includes everything from shampoo to lotion to soaps to lipstick to hair coloring products and so much more. In the U.S. alone, it's an $80 billion plus industry, and it's projected to keep growing. Given its size and scope, you might think there would be a stringent safety net in place to protect us all, but that's not the case. The Food and Drug Administration has taken a largely hands-off approach when it comes to regulating personal care items. That could be coming at a steep cost to our health. These products often contain a long list of chemicals, some of which might be relatively harmless, but others, like mercury and formaldehyde, come with well-known health risks. And our exposure is significant. On average, women use 12 personal care products a day, exposing themselves to more than 160 chemicals daily. Men, on average, use 6 products, exposing themselves to some 85 chemicals. But a clean beauty movement is gaining momentum, drawing attention to the gaps in the regulatory system and the impacts on consumers, and pushing to fill those gaps. Here with us today to discuss toxic cosmetics and the effort to clean up the industry are Melanie Benish, legislative attorney with the Environmental Working Group, Ami Zoda, an associate professor with the George Washington University Milken School of Public Health, and Janet Noodleman, director of program and policy with the Breast Cancer Prevention Partners Campaign for Safe Cosmetics. Melanie, Ami, Janet, welcome to Terra Verde.
Thanks so much for having us.
So I want to start with you, Melanie, and ask if you could just give us kind of a brief rundown of some of the types of chemicals that we should be more worried about in our cosmetics.
Sure. Well, I will start by saying that cosmetics are really one of the least regulated consumer products that there is. And in all the things that the FDA regulates, it's certainly the least regulated FDA product. And so as a result of that lack of regulation, there are a lot of concerning chemicals that find their way into cosmetics with very few consequences. In fact, there are only 9 chemicals that have been banned or restricted in cosmetics for safety reasons. So some of the things that we still see but that we are concerned about are things like parabens, which are linked to hormones. They disrupt your hormones and harm the reproductive system. Phthalates are also known as endocrine disruptors or hormone disruptors and can harm your reproductive system. There are several different types of chemicals like quaternium 15 and methylene glycol, which can release formaldehyde, or different kinds of formaldehyde that can be found in cosmetics. Some of these professional hair straighteners, known as Brazilian blowout, release formaldehyde into the air that stylists and consumers then breathe in during the procedure, and we actually just filed a petition with the FDA asking them to ban formaldehyde in those products. And then there, a recent study came out also finding all kinds of PFAS chemicals in our personal care products, and PFAS chemicals are sometimes called forever chemicals because they don't break down readily in the environment, and they can also build up in our blood. And those chemicals are linked to a variety of health concerns, like some reproductive harms, developmental harms, some kinds of cancers, and even can make our vaccines less effective.
Wow. And Janet, I'm wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on, you know, some of what we know about the health impacts of some of these chemicals.
Sure. No, that'd be my pleasure. So, you know, Melanie really hit the nail on the head when she started off talking about how little regulation exists for the cosmetics industry. And that's a real problem for consumers because this is a big industry that we're talking about. Globally, we're looking at a $220 billion global cosmetics industry that uses over 10,000 chemicals, many of which are industrial chemicals, to formulate the beauty and personal care products that we use every day. These are chemicals that are used in paint strippers or to grease gears or stabilize plastics. There are 4,000 chemicals used to make the personal care products that we bring home to our families smell good, 3,000 chemicals used to impart flavor in mouthwash and toothpaste. So, you know, we're talking about a big industry that uses lots and lots and lots of chemicals linked to many adverse health effects. I work for an organization that's focused on breast cancer prevention. A number of these chemicals are linked to breast cancer, chemicals that can be found in foundation, in nail polish, in sunscreen, in shampoos. But breast cancer is only one of the many adverse health effects linked to a number of these chemicals. They're also linked to cancer, birth defects, learning disabilities, reproductive harm, endocrine disruption. And the problem is none of us live in a bubble, so we're not just exposed to toxic chemicals in the cosmetics we use every day. Some of these same chemicals are also present in household cleaning products, in food packaging, perhaps in our workplace settings, or being emitted from industrial pollutants in our communities. So it's a big problem from a public health perspective.
Right. And Ami, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you know, whether there are some groups who are more vulnerable to these exposures than others.
Sure. I'd be happy to. We can look at disparities along a couple of different axes. So I think kind of some of the first information about the fact that, not, you know, all groups are not equally exposed comes from looking at biomonitoring data. So actually looking at kind of concentrations of these chemicals and their residues in our blood and urine. And we know that women of color, so specifically non-Hispanic Black women, as well as women who self-identify as Hispanic, have higher concentrations of some of these beauty kind of product chemical exposures compared to white women. So like some of the phthalates and parabens that both Melanie and Janet spoke of, you know, they're higher in women of color. And, the, you know, these differences are not explained by socioeconomic status. So it's not just about income or class. Women of color across the socioeconomic spectrum have higher exposures to beauty product related chemicals. We also see that from data in New York that kind of Hispanic Black women have some of the highest concentrations of mercury in their bodies. So, and even though in the general population, fish is the main exposure of concern, in those really highly exposed women, it was actually traced back to skin lightening creams. Mm-hmm. And our own data has shown that, that for example, Hispanic and Asian women use cosmetics more than Black and white women, right? And we know that Black women spend, you know, the most on hair care products. So there are definitely important differences by race, ethnicity when it comes to kind of just total overall kind of purchasing of cosmetics, hair and skin products, and also kind of what products get purchased. And women of color are purchasing and using kind of more toxic products.
And is there, you know, I would imagine those working in certain sectors, say in the beauty industry, salons, are also at an increased risk. Is that accurate? Ami?
Yes. So those working in the nail salon industry and the hair salon industry, and both of, you know, these industries employ women of color, you know, often of reproductive age. You know, we've heard about how pregnancy is a vulnerable window of exposure, and you know, and for them, it's often a source of livelihood, right? So these are issues of environmental justice and economic justice. And, you know, I just also want to point out that a lot of the same groups that are more highly exposed to chemicals and cosmetics also live in neighborhoods facing greater air pollution. So there could be synergistic impacts. And, you know, I think what's another thing that's important in this conversation is, you know, not only talking about kind of who's more highly exposed, but really kind of, you know, being kind of explicit about why they're more highly exposed. And a lot of the work I do kind of really tries to highlight the role of racism and other types of forms of discrimination and oppression, like colorism, and how, you know, these kind of systems of oppression really drive our beauty norms and our notions of what is beautiful, and often drive kind of use of more toxic beauty products.
Right. Thank you. And Janet, I know, you know, we've touched on this slightly already, but I'm hoping that you can expand a little bit on like the ways in which the FDA does currently regulate cosmetics and personal care products. What happens right now?
Sure. So the cosmetics industry, despite its size, is one of the least regulated consumer products industry in the United States today. Most people assume that the FDA regulates the safety of beauty and personal care products the same way that it does food and drugs. But the truth is that could not be more untrue. The FDA doesn't conduct pre-market safety testing or review of the ingredients in cosmetics or the finished products themselves, nor does it require companies to test their cosmetic ingredients for safety before they're placed on store shelves. The FDA can't require the recall of harmful cosmetic products, even if it knows that those products are harming human health. And we saw some really good examples of this problem over the last few years. Most recently, when Claire's was selling asbestos-contaminated kids' cosmetics, and they refused to issue a voluntary recall of the cosmetics, the cosmetic products. There was also an example where when hair care received 21,000 complaints from consumers that when they were using their hair care products, their hair was actually falling out. The FDA couldn't do anything about that problem. And Melanie mentioned at the beginning of the show, Brazilian blowout, which was being marketed as formaldehyde free, and was discovered that the product was actually 10% formaldehyde by weight. And formaldehyde is a known human carcinogen, and the product was actually using more formaldehyde than an embalmer uses, an undertaker uses to embalm a dead person. So it was a really huge problem. Everyone knew it was a problem, and the FDA, you know, asked the company to voluntarily recall the product, and they basically left and said, no, we're not going to, and you can't make us. So it's a huge, huge problem, the lack of FDA authority. In contrast, the U.S. has, with its existing limited authority, has only ever banned or restricted 11 chemicals from cosmetics, and the European Union has banned over 1,500. So the rest of the world stands in stark contrast to what it is we're doing here in the U.S. regarding of the safety of the ingredients in these products. And I'll just mention one last thing, and that is the lack of ingredient disclosure is also a problem, because the chemicals that make our personal care products smell good, fragrance ingredients, are hidden from public view. They just hide under that one word, fragrance, on a product label. And the majority of the chemicals in a cosmetic product are, in fact, fragrance ingredients, which creates a buyer beware situation for consumers because they have no idea what those chemicals are. And so the ingredients in salon products, by law, don't have to be disclosed either. So that's a lot, a big problem.
Yeah, it sounds like there's quite a few gaps in the system as far as regulation goes. I just want to remind listeners that I'm Zoe Loftus-Farin, and you're tuned in to Terra Verde. Today, we're discussing chemicals in our cosmetics with Melanie Benish, who's a legislative attorney with the Environmental Working Group, Ami Zoda, an associate professor at the George Washington University Milken School of Public Health, and Janet Noodleman, director of program and policy with the Breast Cancer Prevention Partners Campaign for Safe Cosmetics. So I want to turn now to kind of some of the more the solution-oriented side of things. And thanks to folks like you and your organizations, there's kind of quite a bit going on that front. So Melanie, I thought maybe you could start by telling us about some of the recent legislation introduced in Congress around cosmetics.
I would be happy to. So there has been recently a bill introduced that would target one specific group of chemicals, those PFAS forever chemicals that I mentioned earlier, that are known to build up in the blood and are linked to some kinds of cancers, linked to reproductive harms and other harms to the immune system. And so there is bipartisan legislation that has been introduced in both the House and the Senate that would basically tell FDA that they've got about 9 months to write a rule that would just outright ban those ingredients in cosmetics. They don't serve an important function in any personal care products, and it's really an unnecessary source of exposure to those chemicals, and we're already exposed to those chemicals in a lot of different places. And so that is one very straightforward chemical-specific piece of legislation that's been introduced. And then there has also been introduced a more comprehensive bipartisan piece of legislation in the Senate, led by Senators Feinstein of California and Senator Susan Collins in Maine, that would really try to update and modernize FDA's authority over cosmetics so that it's more in line really with consumer expectations. Because as Janet mentioned, a lot of consumers wrongly believe that someone is out there checking the products that are on the shelves before we bring them into our homes and put them on our bodies. And so some of the major changes that bill would do include requiring companies to register with the FDA. Right now, that's entirely voluntary. So FDA doesn't even fully know who all the players are in this market that they're supposed to be regulating, where those facilities are located, or even how to get in touch with the cosmetics company if a problem is discovered. Likewise, there would need to be more ingredient disclosure to the FDA so that FDA has a better sense of all of the different ingredients that are being used in this product that they've been tasked with regulating. It would require mandatory recall when a product is causing serious health harms. Right now, any recall of a personal care product, even a very harmful product, is entirely voluntary. FDA does not have the authority to force a product off of the shelves. Likewise, serious adverse event reporting, this is when a consumer makes a complaint to a company. It is entirely up to the company whether or not they are going to share that information with FDA. There's no legal requirement to pass that information along to the FDA. This would change that so that if you are getting a serious consumer complaint about a harm that the consumer is experiencing from your cosmetic, the company would then have to report that information to FDA and share that information with FDA. It would also force FDA to take a look at all of those different ingredients that are used in these products that we put on our bodies every day, and really look at the safety data and make a determination whether those ingredients should continue to be used or if we need to put some restrictions, either ban them outright or limit the amount of concentration that you can use or use other restrictions to ensure that people are safe. It would also close a few of those other loopholes that Janet identified about professional use labeling, labeling of ingredients on the internet, and also addressing the fragrance issue by requiring at least fragrance allergens, so fragrance ingredients that are known to cause an allergy that have been identified by the European Union as allergens, that those ingredients would require to be required to be disclosed. So a lot of changes to update FDA's authority.
And Janet, should we expect additional legislation coming down the pipeline anytime soon?
Yes, this is the season for cosmetic safety reform, to be sure. So in addition to the big base bill that Melanie mentioned that Senators Collins and Feinsteiner introduced just a couple of weeks ago, and the PFAS ban bill, there are five more bills in the works, maybe six. So there are two bills that are being fashioned after a couple of laws that were enacted in California last year having to do with cosmetic safety. And so last year, Governor Newsom signed a bill into law that would force the disclosure of fragrance and flavor chemicals present in cosmetic products sold in California that are toxic to human health or the environment. And we took this bill to Congress, and it is going to be introduced at the end of the month by Representative Schakowsky from Chicago and Representative Doris Mitsui from California. There was another bill signed into law in California that would ban 11 of the worst chemicals in cosmetics. And we actually worked on this bill with EWG as well, and 13 perfluorinated chemicals. And this group of chemicals are currently banned by the European Union, now banned by the state of California, also banned by the state of Maryland just a couple of weeks ago, but again, present in products sold legally in the U.S. So this bill will also be introduced in Congress at the end of the month. But the PFAS ban will be expanded beyond the 13 PFAS chemicals to the entire class of PFAS chemicals to be consistent with the class-based approach to regulating these terribly toxic chemicals that that is being utilized by lots of advocates. There's another bill that will be introduced at the end of the month that will address cosmetic safety concerns, particularly facing vulnerable populations, two vulnerable populations, women of color and professional salon workers. And this is a bill that's being developed by the Campaign for Safe Cosmetics, the California Healthy Nail Salon Collaborative, and We Act for Environmental Justice. There's a bill that will address supply chain transparency so that cosmetic companies can get the ingredient disclosure, the safety and toxicological data that they need from their suppliers in order to make safer products. Another bill to be introduced by Representative Schakowsky. And then finally, Representative Sean Patrick Maloney from reintroducing the Natural Cosmetics Act. And that bill will address false marketing claims made regarding natural products by codifying a federal definition of natural. So those are just a few of the bills that are expected to be introduced soon.
Yes. I just want to add something. Okay.
Please.
Yeah, this is Ami. I just want to kind of add to the conversation regarding other types of legislation that have passed that may also impact kind of use of products and you know, consequently, people's toxic chemical load and downstream health effects. And I want to talk about the Crown Act, which stands for Creating a Respectful and Open World for Natural Hair. And this is a law that prohibits race-based hair discrimination, which they define as the denial of employment and educational opportunities because of hair texture or protective hairstyles, including braids, locks, twists, or bantu knots. And so the Crown Act, you know, I think is really relevant to the conversation we're having because it can reduce the threat of women wearing, especially Black women, children, wearing their hair naturally, and can kind of, by addressing racial discrimination, can actually reduce the need for toxic products like hair straighteners. And this has actually, so the first state to pass this was California in 2019. And since then, 13 states have passed it nationwide. And so I think it's important to think expansively about the types of legislation that we can implement to address all aspects of kind of, you know, beauty, you know, around kind of beauty and health.
Definitely. Thank you for bringing that up. And, you know, unfortunately, we're running close to the end of the show. But Ami, I did want to ask you one more question. I know you've been involved in legislative efforts, but you've also kind of proposed another way of addressing this issue, which is through the healthcare system. And I wonder if you could just briefly tell us about that.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think it's really important to have clinicians, you know, at the table, especially OBGYNs, because, you know, they really kind of engage in so much of healthcare, especially around women's health. And so, you know, in recent years, there's been more of an effort to engage clinician scientists as well as professional societies. You know, health professional societies, and there's been a lot of recent traction around, you know, like OBGYN health professional societies making statements, you know, kind of really declaring how toxic chemicals are a threat to the women's health. And even recently, I think there was an updated guidance around kind of prenatal counseling of chemical exposures, both workplace and otherwise. So I think the more people we can engage in this conversation, the more impact we'll have in actually reducing the public's exposures to toxic chemicals.
Well, gosh, thank you all so much. I wish we had more time to go even deeper, but you all covered a ton of ground, and that's all we have time for. So thank you, everyone, for tuning in. Thank you to Ami, Janet, and Melanie for joining us today. And thank you for our sound engineer, Miko, and everyone at KPFA. This show and others are available online at kpfa.org for your listening convenience. Have a great weekend.
So I decided to use this kind of analytical mind that I have. And I said, okay, wait a minute, let me think about this. I said, is there anything wrong with watermelons? No. Is there anything wrong with the watermelon man? Nope. That was my answer. Was there nothing wrong? And so it was right then that I decided I have to stand up for what I believe in and what is right and what I feel, follow my heart. And there were even some musicians that, you know, when I told them I wrote this song called Watermelon Man, they said, you're not going to call it Watermelon Man, are you? No, really, it was like that back then.
KPFA, storytelling for social change.